I don't really get this fascination that people have with the ocean.
I've never really liked the beach. The whole thing feels like a scam. There's water and there's dirt. Occasionally some strange creatures that may pay you a visit. But I've always been forced to go to beaches because they're all around me. Usually I'd go to those on the south of the island because that's where most of us live, but every now and then in the summer we may go to the more expensive resort adjacent ones up north that they save for all the white people. The white people themselves were always kind of a spectacle and almost made the beach visits tolerable because you don't see them very often. Whole families will save up to pack up their bag and pan to come visit our beaches. God knows why. It's just water, dirt, hot sun, and some allegedly exotic foods. Well, actually, I get that part. I too would pack up and flee if I was forced to unseasoned processed goods every day after a long day of soul-sucking torturous work. The world is yours, so as payment for enduring the agonies of capitalism a whole year, I suppose they feel entitled to eat other people's food and contaminate their water. I would too if I could.
Tonight's gonna be fine. Tonight's gonna be fine, so if you wanna go out and swing and have a ball, please do that. Boy, I'm telling you, the tourist business was good for Jamaica this year. And I was happy, I'm particularly happy about the tourist business being good this year, because I tried my best to tell the people all about the tourist business.
Tourism has been defined by my main homie Britannica as the act and process of spending time away from one's own home in pursuit of recreation, relaxation, and pleasure, making use, of course, of the commercial provisions of services.
What do you guys want to do first?
I vote we go see the big Jesus first.
Alan, I think you mean Christ the Redeemer, dude.
This was supposed to come out during the summertime, but unfortunately, my mental health took me, and I stopped to talk about a show that makes me happy. But you see, summertime is the season when many of you take great use of this tourism thing. Whenever I am dragged out of my home by my family to spend some time along the north coast of the island, that's when I start to see a large surge of white people. I don't see white people every day besides on the screen, and when I was younger it used to be exciting. It was like seeing the people on television in real life, and they were here because they loved us, or at least our stuff. No Place Like Home was a partially finished Jamaican film by the absolute goat Perry Henzel, initially planned to be the follow-up to his masterpiece, the first and still greatest feature-length Jamaican film ever, The Harder They Come. This one explores a bit of what we call tourism, as we watch a team of American filmmakers come to the sandy beaches of Jamaica to film an advertisement, which I hear is very common. However, a producer of the film, through a series of circumstances, is separated from her Caucasian brethren further and further, and is acquainted with but a glance of what the island is actually like.
So, I mean, all your husband sees is just like making a bag of cash and can't spend it. What you wait to do is bring him down to Jamaica and help him relax.
I mean, what would he do here?
Just bring him down, man.
I'd like to think, rather, I hope, that most people at this point, definitely people watching this, unless the algorithm is playing tricks on me, again, know on some level that tourism is a bit evil. Particularly the type that survives on the cannibalism of smaller countries by people from bigger countries.
We can go to the beach too, Gleb. Don't you worry. I know you want to see all those sexy Brazilian girls.
Whoa, okay.
We know by default, if a significant portion of the population of these countries is living in poverty, you having a grand old time at the beach is a sign that something disgusting must be happening. Surely you must feel a little something in your stomach. However, tourism is designed to go out of his way to hide you from all that.
Pip, which one are we staying at? Is it super close by?
I don't know. Why are you asking me?
What do you mean? You're the one that's in charge of all the hotel stuff.
No, Alan was in charge of that. Him, I sent you a link on Messenger.
Jamaica is an objectively beautiful place, I think. Why wouldn't people want to shoot their aesthetic commercials here? No Place Like Home is actually one of the most stunning films I've ever seen. I love the grimy 1970s aesthetic anyway, and it beautifully paints the landscapes here into the hazy, dreamlike world that foreigners apparently view it as.
And you look outside, you see the vines coming down, you say to yourself, this is an impossible place to be, like Adam and Eve, if, you know, they were here, this is where they would have been.
Would have been Carl Bradshaw.
Because if they weren't here, they made a mistake.
But when the producer runs off with Carl Bradshaw's character, the dream becomes more complicated. But make no mistake, it is still a dream.
You shall let the word of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Jah.
In between her little love affair with a strapping black man and beachside night clubbing, we hear conversations.
Leave him go where? Leave him do what?
To most of him leave.
Tell him say he can't put up all them notices him want.
No, man, what? Government can't deal with it.
Government in backside.
News stories.
When asked about the recent raids in Western Jamaica, the commissioner said they would continue until he was satisfied that the links between hippie tourism and the drug trade were severed.
We see some things.
Soldier man life hard.
Soldier we spend most of his life in the army and he never even get one little man to kill.
Hush up, shut him out.
Soon enough, she realizes that the dreamlike wonderland she came to shoot her commercial in was just that. A dream. One carefully carved out to appease her and her people.
I don't say they can't put up them hotel and bring in them light and them telephone. But they must leave space for me.
But these aren't her problems. In the end, she can, and does, return to her world. The memories of Coconut Land fading into the abstracted haze of one strange summer long ago. A gripe I have, which I voiced already, is stories which take and center the perspective of the majority while examining the oppression and exploitation which they deal out to those outside of their demographic.
Are you an employee of the hotel?
Yes.
When you talk to me, you must say, sir. You understand? Sir. Oh. You have my keys?
He's a bad man.
He's a white man who acts them
crazy. This film is very much about a privileged white lady realizing that everything else exists. White guilt cinema strikes again.
You definitely didn't book it because
I really thought Alan was booking the hotel
I was booking the flight.
However, what's interesting here is that this is not some American Hollywood film. This is an independent Jamaican film, one of the very first at that. Its own production is a story and a half. And this is clearly a film shot and set in the 1970s, but the production date says 2006, the year its director died, only released at a film festival in 2019 by his daughter, Justine Henzel. What happened is that while the filming in Shillong for years, 1973 to 1980, Perry Henzel, who had to fund it out of his own pocket, ran out of funds, and put the finished reel in storage in New York. Then, when he was ready to continue with it in 1981, the footage was lost. And he never made a feature again. I always throw dirt at the Hollywood system, because the idea that the greatest Jamaican filmmaker could ever do it had to struggle this way just to make his second feature. Meanwhile, we get studios up there making deliberately disposable trash, which is guaranteed to break in millions, should make anyone mad. But the thing about Henzel, which you might notice, is that he himself was a white man who came from wealthy plantation owners. He was a radical leftist counterculture type, and it shows in his work, but he did have the access to education abroad and wealth from his family, which is why he was the one able to make the first Jamaican feature, which did in fact center the black working class Jamaicans trying to make it in this damn system.
It was the first in a cycle of three stories. How Did They Come was the first of those three stories, and it was to explore the city through the eyes of a country boy.
But for this, his second, we are taken with the white lady. It has the same commentary, it has the same politics, this one being arguably more pessimistic than The Harder They Peak. But here, we are quite deliberately appealing to the white outsiders, and trapping them with the aesthetics of tourism.
What are you going to do?
Well, I think that business could help.
Like what?
Tourists.
Tourists?
Yes, man.
We call them in the morning.
Yes, man. They talk about it. It's just that you can see it.
But what I'd like to present to you is the theory that that is the point. Appealing to the majority. I haven't left Jamaica since I was 11, approximately 9 years ago, but I've had lots of interesting tourism experiences since.
Like you, yeah, are you a tourist? Are you a tourist?
Yes, we're tourists.
Do you have any cash? cash.
I'm not giving you the answer. No, we're not, sir.
I once mentioned that when I was 14, I was invited to go to a famous tourist site. It was Duns River Falls. I was invited to go there with my best friend because we don't do things together outside of school nearly enough. But instead of enjoying the moment, I decided I would rather sit there on the beach drawing a manga one shot that I had assigned for myself to finish that summer. Perhaps just to prove to myself that I could.
But listen, you have a very good stay in Brazil, my friend, alright?
Dude, when he f***ing moved his arm, I thought he was gonna hit me.
Another time I spoke about how once when my cousins from the US were visiting and we stayed at a resort, I realized how disgusting tourism is when I saw them white people on a party boat dancing to songs about oppression. It might interest you to know that then, on that very trip, I sat on that beach, brushing up the finishing touches on the script that would become my first video essay. Would it be absolutely crazy to reveal to you that by sheer coincidence I wrote most of the first draft of this one at a beach resort too? I was almost done editing my Boy Meets World video, but the wind was making me nauseous.
I don't really get this fascination that people have with the ocean.
No?
Yeah.
I truly derive no pleasure from these places besides the buffets. I don't care for beaches. I don't care for pools. I'm not a fish. I care about working. I work too much and I just can't stop. Or maybe it would be more accurate to say I feel uncomfortable when I'm not working. I fear not getting things done. I fear letting opportunities slip away because of things I haven't done, because of self-preservation or whatever. Besides, I just don't know what to do at these places. You do what exactly when you're in a pool? Flop around, hold your breath for a few minutes? Is that fun for you people?
I mean, I stare at it for 10 minutes and I go, okay, I get it.
Don't you feel calmer?
I feel aggravated that I'm missing what other people are getting.
Carl is navigating these different worlds he finds himself in. One is his home and the other is the imagination of this white lady and her friends.
So if you're for the wall, hit the done.
It's alright, man, the wall will finish. The man won't run away. He'll not live a soft life like you.
He and eventually the goat countryman play their role and act as pseudo tour guides, introducing this woman to the magical, mystical world of Jamaica. First trying to shield her away, but soon enough, showing it like it is. Because she wants to know.
God has Satan, almost one, you have to defend, you can't defend the two, you're late. So you get stuck by defending the two powers.
Apparently when they lost the footage from the film in New York, the reel that they replaced it with was that of a porno film. Honestly, the poster kind of looks like a porno too. But that is quite thematically accurate to what this is. These two strapping black men are showing this white lady the world and helping her in her road to self-discovery. They are sort of offering themselves on a platter here. It reminds me of those frightening wood carvings of a Rastaman with very large,
really, really long, trunks
that you encounter on the North Coast. I remember the first time I saw one of those. It's so grotesque. Like, who is this for? White ladies. That's who they're for. And certain types of middle-aged white men. There's another Jamaican film, not as good in my opinion, about just that, also starring Carl Bradshaw though. But what stands out to me about what Carl and Countryman are doing here is that they are offering themselves as a kind of service, trying to ensure that the white lady is fine on her own personal journey. I talk funny. Recently, I've taken to listening to Tenement Yard Media's podcast, and for some reason, I was initially taken aback when I heard them talking Patwa. When I, even on a subconscious level, try to downplay my accent. Language, at least in Jamaica, is a touching subject.
Peter, what's a bomboclaat?
Bomboclaat is one of Jamaica's passwords that relieve the spells of evil.
Patwa is the official language of the Jamaican people, but standard colonial English is the language you'll see on paper.
I was born and raised and grown up in colonialism and exploitation. And I heard that bomboclaat, rasclaat, bloodclaat is indecent language. I'm born come here in Jamaica, so why is it indecent?
Patwa, the Jamaican Creole, is the standard language you will normally hear Jamaicans use to talk to each other, particularly the working class majority. However, standard English is the language they use on television. It's the language we use for official documentation. It's the language which Kingstonians use to speak to each other.
What are you doing there?
Me too. When you use Patois as a Jamaican, you are indicating that you are speaking to other Jamaicans, preferably as a Jamaican. When non-Jamaicans use it, it's kind of cringe.
Wagwan, Jamaica!
Some people like it, because we always like when our existence is acknowledged by the world, but it is kind of tacky. When you use standard English, you're either speaking to that bourgeois, or trying to appeal to some alleged general standard audience. I've generally been an English speaker because I interact more with American media than human beings, but here I definitely do put on a little bit of an Americanized / English accent when I speak into the mic.
Let me give you a tip. Use your white voice.
Man, I ain't got no white voice.
Oh, come on, you know what I mean.
When I did speech and drama in grade school, we were taught to speak properly, and that proper sound tended to sound a tad British. One of my blind spots I've realized as a creator and artist in general, to be honest, is that I'm very bad at narrowing down what demographic or audience I'm trying to appeal to, which is why most videos on my channel are pretty different from each other. I try to always preserve myself and be honest, but you know, pinning down the audience has always been kind of difficult. Sometimes I feel like my audience is too far left and requires some knowledge from me that I just don't have. Sometimes I think my audience is too self-helpy, and not only do I hate that kind of stuff, I think I'm too much of a mess myself to deserve that. One thing that has never explicitly entered my head though is where my intended audience is coming from. I just talk, and those who care to listen will hear. Because I do talk about my experience of being from a non-quote-unquote first world country a lot, I realize some of my more active audience members are also from the global south, from places like India, Mexico, Venezuela. While those who support me on Patreon, most of them are from the US or UK, where the YouTube analytics tell me most of my audience comes from. One thing that's been at the absolute back of my mind though, has been how many people who watch are actually also from Jamaica. In my mind, it's almost no one. Because, well, I haven't exactly been trying to pull a Jamaican audience.
You wanna make some money here? Then read the script with a white voice.
This very video is the first one where I've ever even spoken about a Jamaican film. But the truth of it is, even if it is on a subconscious level, the plan for me was always to reach and be accepted by that international audience. Maybe so I could be one of them.
The Trump's business is the money business, and the money business is the right business, honey. You can't make it unless you got some money, so just get some money, and once you get some money, you just might get some love.
We're just calling because we're in Brazil right now. We don't have a hotel, and we're just wondering if you had any ideas of maybe, like, you know someone here that we can stay with, or...
Wait, you guys don't have a hotel?
No, we don't.
I'd like to think most people know on some level that tourism is bad. But also, if not for tourism, we'd starve. I find it a bit annoying now that my lived reality is just a pit stop for cruise ships and a quick place to recuperate from the tyranny of corporate coggery and the demands of Western civilization. But don't get me wrong, please do continue. Most of our economy sort of depends on how much of a convenient footstool we are. We all might die if not for the role we serve in the hierarchy of the Western world, so please do continue. In fact, let me pull you a chair. Enjoy the delights of the old sun-kissed sands, feel the caress of the ocean breeze, delight in the seasoned foods and exotic fruits. Or, who am I kidding? You're watching a video, so you bunch of nerds. Visit a historic site, maybe a great house. Explore the mysteries. What secrets do they hold? Learn a bit of colonial history of the slaves. Educate yourself on the horrors of slavery while acquainting yourself with the scoundrels who owned them. Most of the hotels you visit are built on the very plantations where they worked. But that's not special. That's almost everywhere. Where I live used to be a sugarcane plantation. Where I go to college used to be a sugarcane plantation. Some of the few relics we have of those days that have remained untouched are found on those sacred grounds of the great houses and, well, we still can't touch them. But take your pictures. Education. Here of the totally not fictional reign of the Wicked Witch of Rose Hall, Annie Palmer, who murdered man after man while practicing her voodoo and brutalizing her slaves in the most horrific ways possible. I like Rose Hall Grace House, actually. I quite enjoy going there and all the other great houses. I'm slandering them a bit, but I like them too. I love them, actually. I do recommend those. It's the only form of local cultural tourism stuff that I actually like. They're fun and they're educational. And they're good for the economy. That's the thing about tourism, you know. This stuff's very fun and good for the economy. The Wicked Witch of Rose Hall is a nice little racist legend that the tourism ministry continues to pretend is real because it appeals to the image of Jamaica in the tourists' imaginations and is good for the economy. It's very easy and fun to learn about foreign cultures. Bonus points if it has something to do with oppression. Maybe you're like me, you don't care for beaches. Perhaps you even prefer to learn about the rough, gritty truth. We're in the business of telling that story too.
Wanted for theft. You are wanted for theft. We know who you are, and you're going to get caught. Those who steal are a burden to those who pay. The penalty for stealing electric power is prosecution, fines, or a term in prison. If you are stealing, you are wanted.
Crime and violence, we rank high on that, don't we? So maybe you're a Tyler Oliveira type, investigating the grime.
That's a big old knife. Have you ever had to use it on anyone?
No, it's gonna take him.
Try to walk through Trenchtown without getting shot challenge, am I right? Like and subscribe.
Done on!
Your workshop's all flooded,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, it's should repair it. I need a repair and come on it today. But I'm still going, I can't make that stop me.
There's just mosquitoes everywhere. You come to a place like this and people are just scrambling through the dump and a lot of this gets recycled with.
Maybe you don't watch No Place Like Home and prefer films like Shutters or Third World Cop. Beware those damn coconuts, they just can't help it. This is why we just must keep them out of our clean, precious countries, right?
The Democrats say, please don't call them animals, they're humans. I said, no, they're not humans. They're not humans, they're animals.
Protect the cats and dogs, Jesus.
So we've just stopped here because a woman has been shot in the street.
Well, the crime stuff doesn't happen, you know. I mean, I personally have never actually had some run-in with the crime and violence thing, which apparently plagues us, but I do come from a certain part of society. But just as bad as the avoidance of issues is, I think some of you out there are just a bit too hyped about the suffering. Seeing us die off. Relishing it. Sometimes. I knew someone once. British, but non-derogatory because she's black. We were doing a history course. It was so interesting how differently she was responding to the material than the rest of us. This was the time when I was getting all educated and woke, so learning about my country's past had now stopped being boring like I'd always promoted in my childhood and began to get depressing. She loved it though. It was all so fascinating because she was going back to England in a few months. The way how the Caribbean was originally inhabited by Native Amerindians soon enough to be discovered and immediately put to work and largely but not entirely by Columbus and his goons, only to be replaced with the introduction of the transatlantic slave trade, Jamaica being run by the Spanish only for the English people to attack under the pretense of religious difference, then engaging in battle after battle. Soon enough, the remaining Tainos teaming up with the runaway African slaves to fight the colonizers as well. Then the country briefly serving as a little pirate haven until God Almighty struck them down with the Port Royal earthquake. Then to eventually, after a bit of motivation by the French, have country after country, population after population, fight like hell for their emancipation. Eventually gain that emancipation, only to face increasingly creative forms of oppression by the English, even after gaining their independence. Then for the Americans to swoop in and get even more creative. Yes, I just speed ran the entire history of Jamaica over the past 600 years for a bit. It is a very interesting story to hear about when it doesn't increasingly crush your very soul that your whole existence was built from some of the worst possible forms of oppression that have ever been enacted from one people to another. It gets really crushing when you see them tourists shaking their tushies to resistance music. It's all very interesting. But I just didn't want to think about Maroon Wars and pirates. I wanted to make comic books. And I can't lie to you, I've tried to escape it.
Okay, let me see.
We can figure this out on ourselves. We're just wondering and...
Yeah, I don't know.
We'll figure it out,
I hate the beach. Now. I hate the beach now. I don't think I've always hated these bodies of water. In fact, there was probably a time when I loved them. I managed to drown almost 3 times in my childhood, and when I tell people that, they always assume that that's why my friendship with water activity ended, but that's not quite true. At least up to the age of 11, I can remember enjoying some nice swimming pool activity, but maybe even as soon as the next year, I stopped saying I liked it. It's the beach. It's always the beach.
Et puis, comme souvent, je vais regarder la mer.
Summertime, you want to have fun. Where do you go? Either abroad or the beach. Preferably attached to some bourgeois hotel. I haven't been abroad in almost a decade. They won't let me. So it's always the beach. It's a birthday, go to the beach. I get invited to have some nice time with friends because I don't do that enough. Waterfall and beach. I feel like Ken.
If I wasn't severely injured, I would beach you off right now, Ken.
I'll beach off with you any day, Ken.
Hold my ice cream, Ken.
Beach, 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 beach. There are other things you can do, you know. There are amusement parks, bowling alleys, arcades, and of course the cinema. All activities directly borrowed from other countries. As in our steady growth of development, as the government loves telling us, we start to look increasingly like those other countries. And more of our stuff is owned by them too. I began to notice how limited my options were. I began to notice how little my actual specific interests were given any opportunity at all. I was at least 16 before I first watched a Jamaican film. How many Jamaican animated shows were there? How many of them were good? Or like the American stuff I grew up watching? Like anime. Speaking of anime, why couldn't I buy any manga like the foreigners could? Why is there only like 3 or 4 art galleries I can visit? And why are they all in like the same place? Why is it that whenever I need to get cool art supplies, they have to be bought abroad? Why does almost all of my family now live abroad? And why haven't I been able to see them in a decade? It seemed increasingly clear to me that the card I had been dealt must have been some kind of mistake. I didn't want to go to the beach anymore. La Dolce Vita is a film I've spoken about on my channel once in what was probably my first good video, which has since been age-gated because the first thing I do is discuss the aesthetic value of porn. But La Dolce Vita is one of my favorite films of all time. Like, top 5. Actually, top 4. Follow my Letterboxd. But the reason why it is that I like it has been that great mystery. The reason I tell myself, and I think in my head, is that the story is very relatable to me. In a bad way. The other is that I use it as a means of escapism. I mean, it's not that deep though, it's obviously both. I use it as escapism because I relate to it. Because I am. Marcello! La Dolce Vita follows tabloid journalist Marcello Rubini, played by Marcello Mastroianni, as he documents and indulges in the pleasures, debaucheries, and spectacle of Italian high society, neglecting those closest to him.
Marcello!
Cosa vuoi? Ma cos'è che vuoi?
No, no. Ti aspetto qua. Cos'è che vuoi mangiare? Qualcosa di leggero. Ti faccio un bel piatto.
He's sooner engaged in a one-sided love affair with well-to-do Maddalena than pay any attention to his actual fiancée.
Le parrà strano, ma io credo di conoscerla bene. Il giorno in cui lei capirà di amare Marcello più di lui stesso, sarà felice.
Marcello lives in a cheap little place, but he's always frequenting the cabarets, parties, and other features of Italian high life. Perhaps even to escape from his real life.
Marcello, ma mi vuoi bene?
He will run around and flirt with the ethereal American actress Sylvia.
Tu sei la prima donna del primo giorno della creazione. Sei la madre, la sorella, l'amante, l'amica.
You can barely understand him, but he will never actually be able to touch her.
Listen.
Sylvia.
In La Dolce Vita, we are taken with Marcello into these worlds, getting our mere glimpses, but make no mistake, this world is not ours. Maddalena doesn't really care for him, at least not in the way he clearly cares for her. He will probably never see Sylvia again. This world is empty and hollow. Yet Marcello is constantly drawn to it.
Dovrei cambiare ambiente. Dovrei cambiare tante cose. La tua casa è un vero rifugio, sai. I tuoi figli, tua moglie, i tuoi libri, i tuoi amici straordinari. Io sto perdendo i miei giorni. Non combinerò più niente.
They won't let me see my family. I don't know why. They never told me. They don't owe me that much, apparently. Almost everyone I grew up with now lives abroad. Most of my friends, almost all of my extended family. I'm still here, though. I was supposed to visit my family several times over the past decade, but, my passport expired. Then once I got that sorted, my visa expired. I went to renew it a couple years ago. They told me no. God knows why, but they told me no. Then this year, on this splendid summer where I lost half my mind, I gave it another go, this time with my own money, going through the process myself. My family wants to see me. They've wanted to see me for a long time, and it's been a long time. I have a whole cousin that was born over there. They visit us sometimes, but I've never been able to see his home. I was his favorite cousin, I think. But my family has had to go without me. I had by all my information together, everything was sorted. We made a plan, can you believe that? We made a plan. This August, I went up there to the People's Dam Embassy for their interview. I went into detail. I inserted stuff they didn't even ask for. I gave them lore. I mentioned I do YouTube. She said, okay. I don't like America. I'm sorry. Have you seen your country? There are other places I actually want to go to. I have no business in America, besides the fact that my family is there and they want to see me. The white lady told me no again. No explanation, no nothing. She never even looked at me. They just won't let me see my family. Argument for the existence of God, I'm being kept here, I think. God, or at least a room full of white people, wants to keep me here. Maybe to learn something.
They're eating the dogs, the people that came in. They're eating the cat.
The last time I went to the US with my family was when I was 11, but I've since fetishized and aspired to visit my share of exotic countries. In my early teens, when I was thrust into my weeb phase, Japan was a country full of cartoons that were cool and edgy, and people were apparently introverts like me, so I'd fit right along. Lots of others in recent years seem to have come to that same idea. Japan has become, it seems, a sort of haven for Westerners to escape from wherever they are because it's so cool and exotic. Their art is so enrapturing and the culture seems so fascinating, even the lettering system is art. So in legions, us Westerners go over there with our preconceptions and have a ball. Some choose to go there and raise hell because the spectacle is just such good content. Others assimilate, living the great weeaboo dream, reading Mishima, building Gundams. It's become a nice little playground of the West. Even if the people are too polite and welcoming to tell us to our faces how they really feel about that. And I really wanted that for myself.
La fugue du chat de Scarlatti.
Then when I got a bit older, I started watching French New Wave films and decided I too wanted the nice New York Herald Tribune, cigarette baguette life, the birthplace of cinema and the artistic capital of the world, at least during the Enlightenment age. France, particularly Paris, has been associated with love and romance for centuries.
My little croissant! Jump into my Peugeot and we would drive on the wrong side of the road!
The arts seem to be respected there in a way that they've never been in the Americas or even other European countries. An increasingly insufferable art geek like myself was taken by all this. But my father, who's actually been to Paris, always insisted it wasn't that hype. A sentiment that seems to have increased over the years. People are talking about rats, bedbugs, the place smelling like urine. I don't know about any of that, that could all be so racist. No matter how many Truffaut films I watch, or Renoir paintings I gawk at, I've never actually been there. Then I got really into Italian stuff, their art history, oh god, Da Vinci, Michelangelo, Raphael. I started watching lots of Fellini, Pasolini, I'd be listening to The Goat, Ennio Morricone, Piero Piccioni, Silvio Caprani. Then my goose was really cooked when I found out I actually have Italian heritage a few generations back on my mother's side.
Mamma mia!
I haven't entirely left that phase. And rolling through Via Veneto with Marcello and Paparazzo has functioned as a form of escapism for me. But I've still never damn been to Italy. I'm just watching movies.
Sembra che sia soltanto un'apparenza e che nasconda l'inferno. Il mondo sarà meraviglioso, dicono. Ma da che punto di vista, se basta uno squillo di telefono ad annunciare la fine di tutto? Dovremmo riuscire ad amarci tanto, da vivere fuori del tempo, distaccati. Distaccati.
Marcello is detached from just about everyone in his life, maybe because he's afraid of that level of vulnerability. The closest thing to a friend we see him have is Paparazzo, who is willing to sell him out for a nice photo op at any moment. Then there's Steiner, someone who he doesn't even know that well, who evidently liked to keep things that way himself.
Tu sei il vero primitivo. Primitivo come Guglia Gotica. Sei tanto alto che non puoi sentire più nessuna voce.
The only other person he even comes close to loving is Maddalena, a door into the world of lights and privilege that he clearly yearns to indulge in, but to her he's just a plaything.
Non so se hai parlato sul serio, se mi prendi in giro, ma non importa. Ti voglio bene, Maddalena. Vorrei stare sempre con te.
Dopo un mese mi odieresti.
No, non è vero. Sei una ragazza straordinaria, Maddalena, io lo so. Il tuo coraggio, la tua sincerità.
Marcello lives the sweet life, just on the outskirts of everything, in detachment and denial of the things closest. Like a terrible washed-up thing on a beach, gazing at nothing in particular.
Questo insisto a guardare.
In 1954, about 10,000 West Indians came to Britain. In 1955, it is believed another 15,000 will make the long journey.
For most of my online presence, though it doesn't mean much because I never had much of an audience at this point, I hid where I was from. Because I felt like it was a big mistake, and to do the things I wanted to or to be in the spaces I wanted to be, I had to be not from where I was. Thought I wasn't supposed to have the things I wanted. Somewhere along the lines, I may have really internalized the idea that Jamaicans just aren't supposed to make films or comic books. Now it's the opposite. I talk about this stuff precisely because the circumstances of my access to these things is different to most of the people watching. But it still feels a way. I can only live out that Italian furniture Japanese fantasy through these stories, because that's all it is, a story. And for most of my life, the God's honest truth is I just haven't wanted to look away. I haven't wanted to face my reality, but I don't know, getting rejected from being able to visit your cousins because of that reality kind of forces you to reflect.
The biggest loss Jamaica's suffered has been the drain of people. The desertion from their homes in the Kingston suburbs of the vital middle class. They're mainly living in America, their houses empty or rented out.
Brain drain is that old plight that they always warned me and my friends about when we were young. Jamaica has such great potential to be something if those of us brilliant people who were born here would just stay and help to build what we have. But in a twisted contradiction, we are also force-fed the messages of countries like America, where hyper-capitalism and individual responsibility and dream-following are praised. I need to get what's mine, and to do that I need to go somewhere that will help me. Like America, or in my cringe hipster case, Japan, France, or Italy.
Non scrivere. Non ti fare fottere dalla nostalgia. Dimenticaci tutti.
But in spite of the fact that all of my life I've wanted to leave, I've been kept here. Forced to look around me, forced to think. I've also benefited from hearing stories of those fortunate enough to get out of here. Your food tastes like it was made in a cardboard factory. Now you have to work multiple jobs in order just to pay rent and your school fee. Now you've been made aware that the pigment of your skin is different from those around you, and in the smallest of ways, people will remind you of that every day. Work twice as hard to get half as much, as they say, it's the old Hannah Montana formula. You feed the kids stories about what a wonderful, glamorous life it is to be a pop star, and soon enough, a whole generation of children will want to pursue that dream. One which you can deliver in a way that benefits you and exploits them.
You don't know nothing about Lady Liberty standing there in a harp, screaming out the wall of nations in a oil. Send me your poor, your deadbeats, your filthy. And all the nations sent them in here. The Spanish PRs from the Caribbean, your Japs, your Chinamen, your Couts and your Hebes, and your ladies come in here. And they're all free to live in their own separate sections. And they'd bust your head if you go in there. That's what makes America great, buddy.
Me and my friends like art. We like making things, and we can make things. No one signed up to be an activist. No one wants to think about big annoying words like colonialism. I want to make videos about Shrek, and not have to use it as an allegory for the exploitation of marginalized groups in society. And no, I'm not making that video. Please don't ask for it. But there are cards we've been dealt in life. I still feel like leaving, but I've also liked to tell myself that I make art to make the world a better place. And I just can't deny anymore that the reason why things are so hard for me and my friends is because people like us like to pack up and leave and pretend like this whole thing was just a bad dream. Being forced to say, I feel like I've been acquainted with the country for the first time. I don't think I've really lived here yet. There's a lot more to this place than beaches and nice food, but there's still more work to do.
I do so they can't put up them hotel and bring in them light and them telephone, but they must leave space for me.
I love movies, yet the only ones in my cinemas are American. I grew up watching their TV shows too. I read their stories, listened to their music. I wanted what the people on the television had because, well, perhaps that was the plan. Perhaps the way you kill a people is to rob them of their language, their culture, their religion. If we get into the religion stuff, oh my god, this video is going to get way longer than it needs to be. I keep talking about Jamaica because I live there, and Jamaicans have this protagonist syndrome thing in the Caribbean. But I think we'll go a long way if we start working together.
Before Manley came to power, the entire Jamaican bauxite industry was controlled by 6 North American companies. The country's greatest natural asset belonged to someone else.
The Prime Minister loves to tell us of the great progress the country is making, and I suppose he's referring to the big building that keep replacing those objectively beautiful trees and forests I spoke about earlier. Or maybe it's of the businesses that have been brought over and operated by large countries like the US and China.
But I'm not asking them. I am telling them that they must leave space to me and the 300 people that put Freddy in power. And you say, Freddy sell we out, we're going to blow up him car, we're going to burn down him house, and we're going to run him out of Dodge.
Not the small businesses by locals, not the way that the local film industry continues to inch along. We celebrate the great American-produced Hollywood biopic that glanced at certain moments of Bob Marley's life and made sure to ignore the deeply uncomfortable historical context that still affects our lives to this day.
Manley's blamed for caring more about third world ideology than about paying the rent. As far as his opponents are concerned, there's little doubt that Jamaica's problems stem from his admiration of Cuba.
We have to make yet another formulaic Hollywood biopic, not explore the way how the US made sure to screw Jamaica over the second the country started moving kinda socialist.
In America, such support of a communist state was like a declaration of war.
Mr. Manley's association with Fidel Castro may be one of the prime reasons that many bankers have turned down his request for the borrowing capacity for Jamaica, why their tourism is at a low ebb.
The crime and violence you see on screen is because it's Jamaica, and we know that the place is violent and full of crime. No way. The cause of that violence and crime is a direct result of the US being spiteful, that it may be less dependent on them, right?
Mr. Manley told me that he thought there was a deliberate policy of destabilization from the United States to get rid of him.
Well, I hope that that makes better politics in Jamaica, that it makes sense with regard to the United States.
It's not true.
It's not true.
But no, no, these are wonderful, wholesome developments. As we begin to look and act more and more like the people on the screens in the big suits, and when those wonderful people need a place to unwind from their own realities, we perform as their little footstool. Because if we dare get on their bad side or look too much like we've developed an identity of our own, we know what those countries can do to us. Why do the Haitians need to migrate? Why is the country in the state that it's in? Are they just bad? Or perhaps, are they being punished by the West for daring to be the first of us to fight you people off and stand on their own 2 feet? I don't want to hear no more Jamaicans talking about how they bring their disaster upon themselves for practicing voodoo.
I was actually thinking the same thing. I just want to go back now, to be honest. Like, I think what we should do is, we'll go back and just, we can plan a trip for the future. Let's really fully get a plan.
I don't think progress should come in the form of looking or acting like those who sit on you, wearing their clothes or speaking their language. Escaping into other worlds and acting as they do won't let you outrun yours. We do need a break sometimes from the blows of the world and the dread of the mundane. I'm not against escapism altogether, but the existence of other countries should not be reduced to the entertainment and leisure of the powerful.
L'ho sempre detto io. L'unica autentica donna è l'orientale. Del resto, dove era Eva? Nel paradiso terrestre. Il paradiso terrestre, dov'era? In Oriente.
If Adam and Eve, if, you know, they were here, this is where they would have been. Because if they weren't here, they made a mistake.
And this is not an individual issue. Like I said before, the economy of much of the Caribbean, quite literally, depends on these little summer vacations to stay afloat.
I threw all my shoes away.
Our problem is bigger. We already know tourism is just a voyeuristic practice that reduces countries and their people to cheap spectacle. But the side of the conversation that I rarely hear brought up is what this does to those people, and how it affects how they view themselves and their own role within the world. When standing on the beach, it is like the vastness of the world is outstretched before you. All the places you've never been, the people you've never met, the food you've never eaten, the clothes you've never worn, the opportunities you've never had.
Non capisco, non si sente.
Yet it is empty. Just a large stretch of water. Perhaps some crashing waves.
Non sento, non si sente.
With all my stresses, ambitions, and lingering pretense of individualism, I keep running and running, trying to escape, but I find myself once again on the beach. The wind keeps me ashore, sand gets in my eyes, the waves whisper in my ear. There's still more work to do. These big resorts founded on plantations owned by descendants of slave owners won't save us. They keep us from starving, but they won't save us. The artifice of tourist escapism and that of those of us who dream of greener grass keep us pacified and subservient. I don't want to go to America and become another pawn of the system. Something, something, Kamala Harris.
No, she's not even black, she's Jamaican.
I want our government to not fund the Haitian. Look, man. After I had already finished this and begun to edit, Donald Trump and the Republican Party of the United States decided to just go mask off and accuse them Haitians of being subhuman animals, basically.
They said, no, they're not humans. They're not humans. They're animals.
I spoke about Haiti a bit in this essay already. I'm gonna do so a bit more because the United States is so racist. They made SNCO drop the act for the first time in at least 3 years. US politics has been so interesting recently, but I've mostly tried to bite my tongue over it, leaving the hardcore political sociology stuff to those who know better, particularly those who are American. But I feel like now not only do I have an excuse, but a responsibility to say something, because a lot of you evidently don't view me or my people as human beings.
In Springfield, they're eating the dogs, the people that came in. They're eating the cats. They're eating the pets.
The original ending of this was going to be a bit more ambiguous and existential, as has become my style, but some things are too important and urgent for that kind of privilege. Donald Trump, on national television, propagated the literal Facebook white lady conspiracy of Haitian immigrants eating people's pets.
Until Donald Trump and I start talking about cat memes, if I have to, create stories so that the American media actually pays attention to the suffering of the American people, then that's what I'm going to do.
You just said that you're creating a story.
Public policy.
You just said that this is a story that you created. So then the eating dogs and cats thing is not.
Which has resulted in the most unabashed, frank display of classic KKK 1930s German-style racism against Caribbean people I have ever seen. Like, this is literally on the level of those grotesque caricatures and fantasies they concocted about Jewish people. I mean, Twitter's just full of that kind of stuff anyway. Like, this is just... What is going on? I just made a 4-hour long video about being young and stupid, but I am consistently humbled by how much worse this world is than I thought. And what burns me the most is how many of my fellow Jamaicans echo these sentiments and repeat these unambiguously racist talking points against our literal neighbors because they do voodoo. Again, I'm probably preaching to the choir here, but these countries consistently prove not to view us as having any value, but to be, well, ironically, pets to be controlled and serve them when they want. It don't matter how much you go to church. It don't matter if you think you're some great artist or thinker. You don't exist. Besides cheap entertainment and a nice little footstool. It's election season. Do whatever you feel has to be done.
I'm surrounded by idiots.
Pay reparations, join a Patreon.